Class, before we start, ganito ha. While lecturing, this will be our protocol. While lecturing, you paki-mute ang inyong mga ano mic.
Anong sagot niya?
O, katulad niyan, hindi na kami.
Anong subject so, niyan?
Criminal law po, Miss Unyo.
O, parang nami-miss ko siya eh.
Oh, Gemaline.
Oh, Gemaline.
Ay, Gemaline.
Yes, oo, sir. Rinig na rinig
yes,
ka.
Yes, sir.
Meron ka bang ilelecture sa klase? Naririnig ka ng klase? Pwede kang bumate, manawagan. O mag-advertise. Ayan ang sinasabi ko sa inyo, class. No? Make sure lahat ng mic nyo nakamute while I am lecturing. If you have any question, ilagay nyo lang sa chat group natin. No, doon kayo magtanong. Pero once we start already with the lecture, wala dapat mag-ano. Walang gagalaw ng mic. So wala na dapat ako marinig na mic. Saka, class, pag hindi kayo naka-open ng video, kasi sasabit natin sa Supreme Court ito, ay ma-consider kayong absent. Unless may sakit kayo, katulad ng, halimbawa, nagpaalam sa akin. Pero kung wala kayong paalam, dapat i-open yung video niya. Kasi, ang sabi ng Supreme Court, synchronous tayo. No? That means to say face-to-face Zoom. So kung pwede lang ang ano eh hindi naka-video, pwede rin ako magturo ng video, but it's the requirement of the Supreme Court. And that una-una synchronous, pagka refresher synchronous. No, pangalawa dapat ay regularly attending the class. So I'm very strict on attending on checking the attendance. Kasi mananagot kami sa Supreme Court. Hindi PUP does not offer refresher course just for compliance purposes. Kung gusto niyong compliance purposes, ang daming law school nag-a-offer ng refresher. But for us, no, because we want you to learn. No, as mentioned before, it's not a money-making business. Kung pwedeng taasan, kaya pa namin taasan yun. Tot, mura pa rin naman ang bigay namin. But that's not the point. No? We want you to become lawyers and we want you to pass already the bar examination to be given next year. So 2 years from now, you'll become lawyers. Okay? So yun. There's still pumapasok pa eh. Okay. Ron, you can also admit ta, no? You're the co-host. Pag may pumapasok, well, I'm already lecturing. Or may na disconnect and would want to to come in again, then you can already accept that person. Okay, so good afternoon everyone. So we will be discussing on general principles of criminal law. We'll start with criminal law. So what is criminal law? Criminal law is that branch of public law which, number one, it defines a crime. Number two, it treats of its nature. And number three, it provides punishment. So how would you know that one is a penal law or not? No? If it has these three elements, it defines what is a crime, it treats of its nature and provides punishment. So there may be a law which you all the while you have this mistaken belief that it's a penal law, but actually it's not a penal law because it does not provide for any punishment. What is the significance why we define one as a criminal law or not? Because if it is a criminal law or a penal law, then it is entitled to what? To a liberal interpretation of the law. Liberal interpretation. No? In favor of the accused and strictly against the government. So if you're the counsel for the accused and there is doubt.
Wala na naman kanina.
Yung
Zoom ko. Hey,
pati-mute. Make sure lahat naka-mute. Huwag na akong paulit-ulit. Okay, so it's strictly against the government. So if you're the counsel for the accused and there is doubt insofar as the interpretation or construction of a specific penal law, you can argue that it should be interpreted in favor of your client, the accused, and strictly against the government. So, now, if it's not a penal law, then you cannot argue. Unless the law provides that it should be interpreted, no, in favor of your client. Okay. Next. Let's go to characteristics of criminal law. Number one, this is a favorite bar question. Generality, territoriality, and prospectivity. When you talk about generality, ang problema kasi is the first and the second is used interchangeably by a student or by a bar candidate, which should not be the case, di ba? When you talk about generality, the first thing that should be in your mind is that it refers to persons. So that will be your guide. Kasi may mga generality, pero yung definition ng territoriality ang binibigay. No. So to clarify this one, just remember that generality, no, in generality, it refers to persons. And territoriality refers to a place. Now, you start with first. So, all persons, para hindi kayo ma-confuse, ma-mislead. All persons living or sojourning in the Philippines are subject to a Philippine criminal jurisdiction. So, lahat ng tao, all persons living or sojourning in the Philippines are subject to our Philippine criminal jurisdiction. So here comes an American. Who's an American in living in New York who visited the Philippines only. Sabi niya, he was arrested for carrying marijuana. Sabi niya, no, you cannot arrest me because I am a citizen of the USA and also under our state law in New York, no, we are perfectly allowed to carry marijuana. So since I am an American, a New Yorker, no, you cannot charge me of that. Question. Is his argument correct or not? Of course not. Because in criminal law, remember this, no, criminal jurisdiction, the nationality law is not material. We refer to it adhere to the generality, territoriality, and prospectivity rule. So even if he's a visitor of the Philippines, he's subject to our penal law. Walang national law, no? Subject to generality, territoriality as well. Now, question, is this an absolute rule or not? This is just a general rule. So titingnan nyo always, class, whenever you study, you have to know what is the general rule and what is the exception or are exceptions. A common problem of some students is that they do not have the concept of what the general rule is, and they are making the exception as a general rule, and that's wrong. Except when under the laws of preferential application and when there is a treaty stipulation. So when the Philippines enter into a treaty with another nation. Pag sinabing laws of preferential application, what does it mean? No? It means that it gives preference to a particular class of person. So nagbibigay ng preference to a particular preference to a particular class of person. So that if you belong to this particular class of person, then Philippine courts have no jurisdiction to try the case. So what could be an example of that under public international law? PIL. So number one is the sovereigns, ambassadors, sovereigns or heads of state, yung mga presidente, ganyan, and ministers, plenipotentiary, ministers, residents, charge of affairs. Diplomats are included, no? But not consul. But not consul. So assuming that si President Biden, the President of the United States, visited the Philippines and he went to the U.S. Embassy, assuming from PICC. So he drove this car going towards the United States Embassy in Manila along Ross Boulevard, and he hit a pedestrian. Unfortunately, the pedestrian died. So can you file a criminal case against President Biden for reckless imprudence resulting to homicide? Not, because of this exception, laws of preferential application, he being the head of state of the United States. So DPR. Next, treaty stipulation. So sample could be the BFA when an American citizen, U.S. military personnel commits a crime against a fellow U.S. military personnel. We do not have jurisdiction to try the case, but it will be the America, the United States, will try the case. But if it is within, if it involves a Filipino and an American U.S. military personnel, katulad ni Pemberton, then we can try the case if it's a criminal case. It can be tried in the Philippines. Or if it involves, a crime committed against the national security of the United States, committed by a U.S. military personnel, then we do not also have jurisdiction to try the case. Okay, so let's go now to, before we go into territoriality, that you have to remember what is the general rule and the exception. Now, tingnan nyo yung exception. Pag wala sa exception, then you apply the general rule. So sabi, you can conclude in your answer, It being not, does not fall under any of the exceptions under the generality rule, hence A is criminally liable because the general rule provides that all persons living or sojourning in the Philippines are subject to our criminal courts. Territoriality rule simply means that, pag muna tayo mag-prospective ha, if the crime is committed, all crimes, sabi natin, place yan, ano? So, pag generality, all persons, sabi natin dito, all crimes committed within the Philippine territory, then we have jurisdiction to try the case. Philippine has jurisdiction to try the case. Ergo, and this general rule, emphasize ko lang. Therefore, all crimes committed outside, labas, sa Pilipinas, outside the Philippines, then we have no jurisdiction to try the case. Wala tayong jurisdiction. So that's a general rule. All crimes committed within the Philippine territory, Philippine courts have no jurisdiction. Philippine courts have jurisdiction to try the case. Crimes committed outside the Philippine territory, walang tayong pakialam doon, di ba? No jurisdiction. Except that this being a general rule, there is an exception to this. Exception. That which is provided under Article 2 of the Revised Penal Code. So these are instances where although it's outside the Philippine jurisdiction, committed outside the Philippine jurisdiction, yet we have a Philippine territory, yet Philippine courts have jurisdiction to try the case. Okay? And they are as follows. No? So, exception. Number one, should commit an offense while on a Philippine ship or airship. Should forge or counterfeit any coin or currency notes and obligations and securities issued by the government of the Philippines. So the second paragraph refers to a forger and counterfeiter. Number three is should be liable for the introduction of the obligations and securities mentioned in the preceding article. It simply means that it refers to a smuggler who smuggled the obligations and securities which was forged and counterfeited outside the Philippines. No? And while being a public officer, should commit a crime in relation to his office. And number five is should commit a crime against the law of nations, against national security, and the law of nations. So remember these exceptions. There are particular also other rule, other laws that expressly state that it has an extraterritorial application, katulad ng the anti-terrorism law. That will be one. Now, if it is not stated therein, if it does not fall under any of the exceptions, then you apply the general rule, which is we do not have jurisdiction to try the case. Just allow me to to share my Hoodle si Caudal. Okay, look at this one. Should commit an offense while on a Philippine extraterritorial application. Or, ibig sabihin, crimes committed outside the Philippine territory. Should commit an offense while on a Philippine ship or airship. So how would you know that that particular vessel is a Philippine ship or airship? So here comes a situation where perhaps natin ang color. Here comes a situation where we have the Philippines and we have Vietnam. Of course, we don't adhere to the 9-dash rule by China, no? Oh, here comes a vessel on the high seas. I say it's neither in within the territory of either of any nation. So, yun, naglalakbay yung isang barko. And a crime was committed inside that vessel while on the high seas. Normally, we do not have jurisdiction to try the case, right? But if it is a Philippine ship, then we have jurisdiction to try the case. So what determines whether it's a Philippine ship or airship? It is the registration. If it is registered in the Philippines, then it's a Philippine ship. If it is not registered in the Philippine ship, it's not a Philippine ship. So kailangan is the act of registration, and that will be before the Bureau of Customs. So, for example, a crime was committed inside the vessel. So, vessel na ito, the crew are Malaysians. We have also the owner. And we have also where the vessel is registered. The crew are Malaysians. The owner is a Singaporean. Registered in Indonesia. O gawin na natin crew, Filipinos. The owner is also a Filipino. But the registered in Indonesia. So question, do we have jurisdiction to try the case? A killed B. A fellow crew inside this vessel. Sabi niyo, we can try the case kasi mga Pilipino naman yan. National law. Diba na-emphasize ko kanina yung national law, hindi mag-a-apply. Owner, Pilipino, hindi rin pwede because what matters is where it is registered. Since it's registered, outside the Philippines, in Indonesia, then we do not have jurisdiction to try the case. Next. Next. Pam. Where is this one? In this vessel, though the crew are Malaysians, the owner is a Singaporean and registered in the Philippines. Crew A, a Malaysian, killed crew B, a fellow Malaysian. The vessel is in the high seas. Do we have jurisdiction to try the case? Yes, because number one, it's not the nationality of the crew, nor the nationality of the owner, but it is where the vessel is registered. And since it's registered in the Philippines, and it is outside the Philippine territory, it being the high seas, then we have jurisdiction to try the case. No problem with that. E paano kung ang vessel ay nakadock, no, sa Vietnam, nag-unload sila. Same facts. Crew, Malaysian, hindi, gawin na natin Filipino. Lahat sila, Filipino. No? Owner is a Filipino, crew is a Filipino, registered in the Philippines. But it is within the jurisdiction of the Philippines. A killed B, both Filipinos. So ang tanong, do we have jurisdiction to try the case? Sabi niya, sir, applying the exception under Article 2, we have jurisdiction to try the case because it's registered in the Philippines and it is outside the Philippines. No, but it's not entirely correct because if the vessel is within the jurisdiction of Vietnam, ikaw ba kung pumatay ka sa Amerika, diba, ang itatry ang sa Pilipinas? No? Hindi, sa US. Also, they have this territoriality principle. Since it is within the territory of another country, then Vietnam has jurisdiction to try the case. Vietnam refuses to exercise its jurisdiction, then that's the time we can do so. Okay? So, ang ibig sabihin nito, while on a Philippine ship, or airship, it connotes a situation. Itingnan nyo sa facts of the case that number one, dapat ang vessel is in the high seas, not within the jurisdiction of another country. Number two, registered in the Philippines. If these two requirements, these two must concur. If this any of these requirements is not present, then we cannot exercise jurisdiction. If it is not registered in the Philippines, wala tayo doon. If it is within the jurisdiction of another state, then wala rin tayo doon. Okay. And what if the vessel is in the Philippines? Nakadock sa Philippines. Pero lahat niyan, ang owner niyan at ang crew are Indonesians. Pero wala tayong jurisdiction. Bakit? Kasi not registered in the Philippines. Eh. Teka muna. No? Is it within or outside the Philippines? It is within the Philippines. So we apply what? The general rule. So all crimes committed within the Philippine territory, no? Philippine courts have jurisdiction to try the case. When it's within the territory of the Philippines, you apply already the general rule. Wala na tayong pakialam if it is registered in the Philippines or not. Importante is this second situation. Registered in the Philippines as well as it should be in the high seas. Registered in the Philippines and in the high seas. If it is within the jurisdiction of another country, we do not have jurisdiction to try the case. Okay? I hope it's clear to you. Next, should forge or counterfeit any coin or currency notes? So, kailangan may forger or counterfeiter. So, ano ang kanyang ika-counterfeit or ipo-forge? Coin or currency notes, of course, issued by the Philippines. And as well as obligations and securities. So, here comes a situation where si S1 or S2 Singaporeans, no? Forged and counterfeited our coin or currency notes. And it was done in their country, in Singapore. So the forger are Singaporeans, no? Committed in Singapore. So because of doing that, they became wealthy, rich. So they decided to visit the Philippines. Sa Palawan, punta sila sa Palawan. But they were arrested. Sabi nila, we cannot under the generality principle because it was committed outside the Philippine territory and we are foreigners. Are the argument raised by these two, S1 and S2, tenable? Of course not. Nationality is immaterial as we have discussed a while ago. And secondly, because it falls squarely under the second exception. Were they forged or counterfeited coin or currency notes issued by the Philippine government? So they can be held liable. So again, second is forger and counterfeit. Yeah. The third speaks about the smuggler. Of what? Of the obligations and securities which was forged and counterfeited. So, halimbawa, S1 and S2, okay, meron silang after they forged or counterfeited, so binigay nila kay S3. S3 is a smuggler. Hindi siya na... He did not counterfeit, he did not forge, but he smuggled these obligations and securities mentioned in the preceding article. So it's not coin or currency note. Under the third paragraph, no, it already deleted coin and currency notes. So it's only applicable to obligations and securities. Dapat ang ini-smuggle I obligations and securities. So we have here in the high seas. So na itong boundary, no? So high seas ito lahat. Philippines and Singapore. So si S3, biginigay niya kay T1. He's a Filipino counterpart, who is likewise a smuggler. Sabi niya, ito yung obligations in securities which was forged and counterfeited in my country. So, sa bangka, nagkita sila, dinala niya sa Pilipinas. Now, itong si S3, sabi niya, teka muna, you have no jurisdiction to try me in the Philippines because no, I never entered the Philippine territory. It was transaction took place in the high seas. Is that tenable or not? It's not because it happened. It will fall clearly under the third paragraph. And because he acted to introduce, to smuggle this obligation and securities which was forged by his friend. So, yun ang application ng third paragraph. Now, a Philippine charity sweepstake, the PCSO issued, is deemed to be an obligation and securities. So, pag yun ang finorge, kahit sa labas ng bansa ng Pilipinas, we have jurisdiction to try that person responsible. Number four, while being a public officer should commit or employees should commit an offense in the exercise of their function. So ang tanong, does it follow that any crime committed by a public officer abroad can be tried in the Philippines? No. Not every crime committed by a public officer or employee can be tried in the Philippines. Why? Because it's very clear under paragraph 4. Should commit an offense in the exercise of their function. So, ibig sabihin, the act, the crime that they committed should be connected in the exercise of their function. So, this is what is material. What is material? So, if that crime is not in the exercise of their function, then we apply the general rule. Crimes committed outside the Philippine territory, we do not have jurisdiction to try the case. But if the crime is connected in the exercise of their duties or functions, then we have an extraterritorial application. It can be tried in the Philippines. So this can be viewed if, for example, in a particular embassy abroad, a disbursing officer, halimbawa sa Singapore, si B is a disbursing officer. Siya nagpapasweldo, in other words. And he misappropriated these public funds intended as salaries of his co-employees. Can he be tried in the Philippines if that act of malversing, misappropriating, happen outside the Philippine territory? No? Yes, because the act is committed with the exercise of their function. So therefore, Philippine courts have jurisdiction to try the case. Eh, paano kung inutusan niya ng isang tao? Halimbawa, yung secretary ni ambassador. O ito, ATM ko, you withdraw 5,000 Singapore dollars because I need that. Ang withdraw pala ng kanyang secretary is 7,000 peso, 7,000 Singaporean dollars. She pocketed that 2,001. Hindi naman ang hingi ng resibo si ano. Well, is there a crime committed? Yes. No? But the crime committed is not malversation. The crime is estafa. Okay? Is it in the exercise of their function? No. No? It's not her duty. Nakiusap lang si ambassador. So in that case, she cannot be tried in the Philippines because the act that she performed, no, was committed not in the exercise of her function. Number 5, should commit an offense against national security and the law of nations. Maraming nalilito dito. Okay, so halimbawa, we have Hong Kong, China, then we have the Philippines. Now, assuming that there is a rebellion, an ongoing rebellion in the Philippines. So here comes a sympathizer by the name of X. He purchased arms in Hong Kong, no, to be delivered in the Philippines to support what? To support the rebellion being committed in the Philippines. Now he was apprehended, no, ang firearms, no, is sent, firearms are sent in the Philippines. So he was, when he went back to the Philippines, he was arrested. Now he was arrested for acts he committed in Hong Kong, purchasing firearms and to support rebellion. In fact, the charge was actually rebellion. Now, ang tanong, can he be tried in the Philippines? Common answer, yes, sir, because rebellion now is a crime against national security. Ang tanong, is that correct? Because if it's not a crime against national security and the law of nations, then we apply the general rule. What is that? Outside the Philippines, then we have no jurisdiction to try the case. Now, rebellion is not a crime against national security. It is a crime against public order. So since it's a crime against public order, then we do not have jurisdiction to try the case. Kasi national security lang and the law of nations. Tatandaan yun. Anong moral lesson? You've got to memorize crimes classified against national security and the law of nations. So if the crime committed abroad would be piracy, mutiny, treason, then triable in the Philippines. Because those crimes would fall under the fifth paragraph. Remember that. Okay, let's go back to the third principle, which is prospectivity. Criminal laws or penal laws should be applied prospectively, or it looks forward. So it cannot be given a retroactive application. No retroactive application. Kaya nga, sa ex post facto law, bawal yon. So at the time that you committed a crime, if at the time that you committed an act, it is not punishable, and subsequently there is a law that punishes that act, then it cannot be given a retroactive application. No, that person should not be liable. Now, can it be given a retroactive application? So there's again an exception. So this is the general rule. No retroactive application. There's also the exception or exceptions where it can be penal laws can be given a retroactive application. And what are those instances? Number one, exception. The only one exception is if it is favorable to the accused. Kung pabor naman sa akusado yan, then it can be given a retroactive application. That's only an exception. That's one only. So if before he was convicted for 10 years and he was already serving the same for 3 years, so may utang pa siyang 7 years na bubunin. But subsequently, a law that was passed, shortening the penalty to be imposed instead of 10 years, binibigyan na lang ng 2 years. Ito si A, na nag-serve na ng 3 years, can now ask to be released. No, because what? It's favorable to the accused. So if you can remember the case of Robin Padilla. No, he was convicted of illegal possession of firearms. So subsequently, there was a law na binabaan yung penalty for illegal possession. Specifically for that act that he was tried and convicted. So nagbumaba yung sentensya. So nakinabang siya. So he was released. But there are exceptions to the exception. Anong ibig sabihin siya? So kahit siya ay, even if the law is favorable to the accused. But if number one, he is a habitual delinquent, and number two, if the law provides otherwise, then it cannot be given retroactive application, though favorable. Pag sabi ng batas, no, if the law provides otherwise, wag bigyan ng wag bigyan ng retroactive application. So hindi ba pwedeng bigyan ng retroactive application? Sa number, pagka habitual delinquent din siya, so hindi siya makikinabang for the new loan that is favorable to him. Now let's go to theories of criminal law. Matagal lang hindi tinanong sa bar ito. Baka tanongin. Number one is classical. Number two is positivism. Okay. Ano ibig sabihin? Classical. Man has a freedom. Freedom siya. Bakit ba naging letter ganyan? E. That's freedom. He is responsible in exercising that freedom. And if in the exercising such freedom, he committed a crime, then he have to be responsible. So there's a specific punishment if he committed a crime. The purpose of the punishment is for retribution. Bigyan ng hustisya. No? But this is the classical. And so far as positivist theory is concerned, no? Man now is imbued with a strange, overpowered by a strange morbid phenomenon which compels him to do something which is against his own volition. And what is the purpose of punishment in positivism? The purpose is for reformation. So on a question, to what theory do we adhere? Tinanong sa bar exam yan. To what theory? We basically we adhere to the classical theory, but in some provisions that we have, we adopted the positivist theory. Like what? The mitigating circumstances, right? Mitigating circumstances, if present, would lessen the penalty to its low minimum period, di ba? There's one theory also, which is the mixed theory, which is the combination of the classical as well as the positivist theory. Let's discuss about Vessel in the Philippines. Ito naman nasa Pilipinas. Kanina, we're talking about when a Philippine ship registered in the Philippines but outside the Philippines. So number one, if it's a foreign vessel, wala. But not registered in the Philippines. So we have a foreign warship and we have a foreign merchant vessel. Okay. Let's put this in a particular case. So this is the Philippines. Okay. This is the territory of the Philippines. Down here is Australia. We have Hong Kong, no? China. So there's a specific private cargo ship, no, from Hong Kong ordered to be delivered. The cargo is to be delivered in Australia. Ang route niya is so, passing through this one. Dadaan siya ng Philippine territory to go to Australia. That's one scenario. The other scenario would be the cargo is coming from Hong Kong and where the port of destination is Manila. Okay. There is a crime committed within that foreign merchant vessel. Now, if the Philippines is the port, sinatawag na port of destination, di kinuha yung karga, i-unload sa Pilipinas, no? So naka-dock ang vessel, then we apply, since it's within the Philippine territory, we apply the territoriality rule where crimes committed within the Philippines, we have jurisdiction to try the case. Now, in the first scenario, ito, it's only in transit. It will only pass through the Philippines. And the port of destination is another country, which is Australia. So if the vessel is in transit in the Philippines, so what is the rule? It's so far as a foreign merchant vessel is concerned. So we could either apply the English rule or the French rule. Now under those two instances, meron siyang general rule at meron siyang exception. A French rule, meron din siyang general rule. He has a general rule. And there's also an exception. General rule, in English rule, no? The host country has jurisdiction. The host country has jurisdiction to try the case. Except when it involves purely internal management. Kung purely internal management, then we do not have jurisdiction. But the general rule is yung the host country has jurisdiction to try the case. Ang French rule, kabaliktaran. No jurisdiction. Host country has no jurisdiction. Except when involves breach of public safety or public order. Okay. So, yun ang rule, ha? So, halimbawa, ang vessel in transit nandito sa Pilipinas. Crew A killed crew B. Australians, no? And the vessel is in transit in the Philippines. Applying the English rule, do we have jurisdiction to try the case? Sabi dito, general rule, the host country has, unless it falls the exception. So let's determine. If it falls under the exception, then we have no host country has no jurisdiction. If it does not fall under the exception, no? If it does not fall under the exception, then we apply the general rule, in which case the host country has jurisdiction. So pinatay ni A si B. Ang tanong, will it fall under the exception? Does it purely involve, do you consider that as purely internal management? Hindi, di ba? Kasi may namatay. At pag may patayan, di ba, it involves yung ating public safety also. No? Yung security ng ating bansa. So in which case, we will apply the English rule, the general rule of the English rule. So we have jurisdiction to try the case, applying the general rule of the English rule. French rule. Host country, no jurisdiction, except it involves breach of public safety or order. Meron bang breach? Yes. Kasi may patayan eh, di ba? So, yung tranquility ng nation is at stake. So, we have jurisdiction to try the crime, applying the exception to the French rule. So whether it's the English rule or the French rule, we will arrive at the same conclusion. Except that we arrive at the that we have jurisdiction in English rule because we are applying its general rule. Applying the French rule, we have the jurisdiction, but because of the exception provided therein. Philippines adhere to the English rule. Pero gayon sinabi ko sa iyo, if the Philippines is the port of destination, so we have jurisdiction to try the case applying the territoriality principle. Kung halimbawa, meron ditong illegal opium. It was landed in the Philippines. So illegal importation na yan under Comprehensive Drugs Act. But if it's passing through the Philippines, may opium dyan, pero nakatago, no? We have no jurisdiction to try. Now, if it is being smoked, yung pernicious effect nun, atamaan yung mga tao dito sa Palawan, no? So we have jurisdiction to try the case, even if it's in transit. Okay, question, sir. Paano, sir, kung ang nakalatag dito ay isang warship? 7th fleet ng US military. Dito siya. No? And A killed B. Duck in that vessel is docked in Subic. Do we have jurisdiction to try the case? Well, you can argue about the exception on the BFA treaty, and you can also provide for this one. A warship is an extension of the flag it carries. Since it carries the U.S. Flag. And if it's a warship, no, it's an extension of the U.S. And we do not have, therefore, jurisdiction to try the case. Okay? Next. Let's go to constitutional limitation. Okay. Constitutional limitation. So we all know that Congress is just a creation of our Constitution. So all laws enacted, whether it's a penal law or any other law like admin law, commercial law, civil law, should conform to the provision of our fundamental law, which is the Constitution. So Congress cannot enact a law that violates the provision of the Constitution. So what are those guaranteed under the Bill of Rights? Due process. The right to be heard. So hindi pa pwede yung Bill of Attainder, no? Yung Bill of Attainder, hindi pa pwede, or ex post facto law. was also a limitation. Bilang pretender, just membership in a communist party would already entail punishment without any judicial trial. So hindi pa pwede yun. Another limitation is, of course, this one, ex post facto law. When it punishes anak, it punishes a person who committed an act which at the time that he committed the same is not punishable. So we also have a presumption of innocence. All accused is presumed to be innocent. Now, notice that, let me just drive the point. Presumption is just a presumption, which can be rebutted. So, ang accused enjoys the presumption of innocence. So, the prosecution has the duty to rebut. And how do you rebut that? By adducing evidence of quantum of evidence, which is proof beyond reasonable doubt. So this is just a presumption. Presumption yan. Which can be destroyed. So ang the goal of the prosecution is to rebut that presumption by presenting proof, by quantum of evidence of proof beyond reasonable doubt. So pagka na-destroy na yung presumption na yan, then he's guilty. Now, if you are the accused, what will be your duty if you're the counsel for the accused, if you're the defense? So, inject a reasonable doubt. Nag-adduce nga ang prosecution ng ebidensya, but it is not proof beyond reasonable doubt. There is reasonable doubt. So kung may reasonable doubt, the presumption stands. Diba? So what else? Of course, other constitutional limitation, the right to a counsel, the right to confront the witness face-to-face or to conduct cross-exam. So kailangan yung ilalagay sa witness stand must have personal knowledge. And of course, he can be cross-examined by the accused. And a lot of other constitutional limitation under the Bill of Rights. So we're through with the general provisions. So we would proceed now to felonies. Let's go to felonies. Let me screen share. Felonies are committed not only by deceit, dolo, but also by culpa. Acts and omissions punishable by law are felonies. The law, this is not entirely correct, but you see, the law referred to here is the Revised Penal Code. Acts and omissions punishable by the Revised Penal Code are felonies. So, special law, we don't call it as a felony. Call it as an offense or a crime in general. So, a felony pala can also be an act. Okay lang yan. When you talk about act, any bodily movement that which produces effect in the external world. But omissions, by doing nothing, you can commit a crime. Ganun ba, sir? Yes. If you hit a pedestrian by accident, you have the duty under the RPC to render assistance. If you fail to render assistance to your to the victim, then you can be held liable. Because there can be a felony by omission. When you talk about omission, what are the requisites? There must be a law that requires the performance of a particular act under a particular circumstance. And number two, there is failure to perform. Yeah. So there is a law that mandates or requires to perform. And there is failure to perform the same. Now, if you were charged, sabi niya, wala namang batas na nagsasabing yun ang gagawin, eh, di ba? So, pagka ganun, walang felony by omission. Bakit walang felony by omission? Kasi wala namang law na nagdidikta na they have to perform a particular act. No? So, remember that. So remember in the Philippines we have this principle that there is no crime when there is no law that punishes the same. You remember this one kasi ano niyo to bahala niyo to sa bar exam. Why? There are cases where you will be asked, you will be thinking, may crime bang ganun? Eh, kung wala kang maisip, ang tagal mo naman nag-aral ng criminal law, no? And you think, if God feel there is no law that punishes the act, then you can use it as your answer. He is not criminally liable, no? Because his act was not punished by any other law. Because we follow the rule that the nullum crimen, nullum poena sine lege. There's no crime when there is the law punishing the act. Huh? So, halimbawa, si A conspired to commit with B the crime of murder to kill X on June 1 and to be executed on June 10. When June 10 comes, it was only B who appeared. A did not appear. So B killed X pursuant to their conspiracy. Now B was arrested and subsequently was charged. And they discovered, no, upon investigation, that A was also acting in conspiracy with the person, with B. So they also charged A. Is A criminally liable? Ang tanong, liable ba siya sa murder? Was there any overt act on his part on June 10? Wala, di ba? So, the only participation of A is by agreeing on June 1. And they're deciding to commit the same. So, is that punishable? In other words, is there a crime of conspiracy to commit murder? Wala, di ba? Wala. So yun, there is no crime when there is no law punishing such act. Okay, let's go dolo and culpa. So there is deceit and there is fault. How do we differentiate one from the other? So, we have dolo, we have culpa. Common element is freedom, intelligence, and third, intent. When you talk about intent, what do you mean? Intent means could be malice, evil intent, bad faith. Ba? Pare-pareho yan. Pag kulpa, there's also freedom, intelligence, but they differ on the third element. In that, sa culpa, merong imprudence, negligence, lack of foresight, and lack of skill. So, ang tanong ngayon, if you are the prosecution, it is your duty to prove these elements, especially if it's dolo. Yung bawa, murder. You have to prove the criminal intent, the element of elements of the crime, and that the accused's intelligence and also freedom. Now, what is the duty of the defense? Kung ako defense, I will negate any one of these elements of this three. Then, wala nang criminal liability ang aking kliyente, right? Negate freedom, there's no criminal liability. How do you negate freedom? Irresistible force. Alam natin, irresistible force is what? It is an exempting circumstance. If present, there's no criminal liability. Intelligence, no? A 10-year-old child who stabbed his classmate, shipmate, no? And died, yung shipmate niya. Is there a crime committed? Yes, because somebody died. Is there criminal liability on the part of A? No, because he's a 10-year-old child. He lacks intelligence. Under the Juvenile and Justice Welfare Act, if the age of the child is 15 or below, there is no criminal liability. Intent. How do I negate intent? As a public attorney's office, how do I dispute malice, evil intent, bad faith? An intent, very specific intent class. Halimbawa, intent to kill. Dapat kung homicide at murder yan, there must be intent to kill. Kung nabuhay yan at walang intent to kill, physical injuries lang yan. Diba? Now, in the crime of robbery and theft, dapat merong intent to gain. Okay? Pagka-rape, there is lewd design. Pagka-kidnapping, there is deprivation of one's liberty or freedom. Now, how do I negate bad faith? So, inindicate ko lahat to by proving yung kabaligtaran ng malice, evil intent, bad faith, good faith. Good faith is a proper defense. So, in dolo, somebody was charged of murder. And I am now claiming that he is acting to defend himself. Self-preservation. So what does it mean? No? Self-defense. No criminal liability. Now when it's culpa, the same two elements, except that there's imprudence, negligence, lack of foresight, and lack of skill. When you talk about negligence, there is it refers to perception. Deficiency of perception. When you talk about imprudence, deficiency of action. Now, how do I negate this one? Merong magitong abogado. Sabi niya, ay, good faith yan. Criminal case yan eh. Okay lang ang good faith. So, is good faith a proper defense in reckless imprudence? So, here comes a person driving, acting in good faith. The speed limit is 20. But his speed at that time, while he was driving his motor vehicle, was 35 kilometers per hour. And he hit a pedestrian. So, ang tanong, is he criminally liable? Sabi ng defense counsel, acting in good faith, not criminally liable. Okay? Tama ba yun? A person may be acting in good faith, but he can be negligent. a person has no intention to kill another person, no? To run over a particular pedestrian. But he's negligent. How do you say he's negligent? He is overspeeding. The speed limit is 25. And this is driving around at 35 kilometers per hour. Huh? So yun ang natandaan nyo. No? Good faith is not a proper defense. Kasi kung murder ang charge yan, pwede. So, what could negate imprudence, negligence, and lack of foresight? Okay. You prove the opposite of negligence, these things. Ano bang opposite niya? Exercise what? Exercise of due diligence. Exercise caution. Kaganoon, in-exercise niya. Okay? So, that's a proper defense. Sabi niya, no, I dispute that my speed is 35. Tingnan niyo CCTV, no? Ang bagal-bagal ko, I was only driving within the speed limit. Huminto pa nga ako eh. Kung hindi ako huminto, hindi ako bumagal. Mamatay siguro yan, no? And he appeared so sudden because he was catching his ball. He was going after the ball that went out. So it was not the fault of the driver. Okay? Tapos na tayo dyan. Next. We also should discuss on Article 3, which is mistake of fact. The case of people versus action. Mistake of fact, there is no criminal liability in this case. No? There's no criminal liability in this case. So you can raise that as a proper defense. As opposed to that of mistake in identity, where it falls under Article 4, Paragraph 1, where there is criminal liability. Mistake of fact. Naalala niyo yung kaso ni Achong, where Achong was in his room. No? So Achong was lying on bed. So another bed which is empty. Somebody was banging on the door. So this person was banging on this door. So Achong was afraid because there were incidents already of crime committed in the neighborhood, in the vicinity. So he asked him, no, sabi niya, who are you? But the question left unanswered. So nagtataka ngayon si Achong. So in the mind of Achong, the person is an intruder. So, fearful for his life, no, what he did is to stab this person. It turned out that that person is his friend, his roommate, playing jokes on him. But unfortunately, he died. So mag-iingat sa pagiging joker, no? Yung I started a joke. Ingat kayo. Ayun na pala ng kaibigan, roommate ni Achong. But he was charged si Achong. And he raised this noble defense of mistake of fact. And Achong was acquitted, actually, because of this one. So ano yung mga yon that he raised? There are three requisites which you need to memorize. His act would have been lawful. His act would have been lawful had the facts been as the accused believe it to be. If
his acts would have been lawful had the facts been as the accused believed it to be. What does it mean? If indeed X is an intruder, just as Achong thought about this person, then his act of stabbing him, this X, would have been lawful. Second, his intent is lawful as well. So there was no intent to kill actually X, no? He was sleeping eh. So he was only defending himself. So it's a self-defense on the part of Acho. And thirdly, is without negligence or carelessness on his part. Walang carelessness and without negligence. How was it shown? Diba sabi ni Achong, he asked question, who are you? But the question was left unanswered. So with these three requisites present, then there is mistake of fact, then there is no criminal liability. Okay? Now, remember, in dolo. Dolo, dapat meron siyang requisites ng dolo. Meron siyang mens rea. At meron siyang actus rea. Okay? Mens rea and actus rea. When you talk about mens rea, what does it mean? There is criminal mind. Actus rea, there is a criminal act. Okay, criminal mind and criminal act. If there is only a criminal mind without criminal act, no criminal ability. If there's only a criminal act without criminal act mind, then no criminal liability. In other words, dapat these two must concur. Kung mens rea lang, criminal mind without criminal act, you can think of any crime. So heinous, but if it stays in the mind, there's no overt act. Not even a preparatory act. No criminal liability. Pero meron bang actus rea? Criminal act, pero walang criminal mind. Yes, yung example that I gave you, yung minor. When the minor 10-year-old child stabbed and killed his fellow classmate, is there a criminal act? Oo, may namatay. Criminal mind? None. Why? Because he is less than 15 years of age. So, kung I heard the prosecution, prove this. Two elements as well. Okay. So let's go to another topic, which is Article 4. Article 4 speaks about how criminal liability is incurred. How is criminal liability incurred? No? Criminal liability is incurred under Article 4, two instances, which is by committing a felony, although the wrongful act done be different from that which intended. The second one is what? When a person has performed an act which would be an offense against persons or property, were it not for its inherent impossibility of its accomplishment or an account of employment of inadequate and ineffectual means. I am looking for another another slide. Sayang. Doon. Okay, good. Kita ko na. I'm sharing to you my book. So, yung wala pang book, no? This is intended again to supplement. Because sa book ni Justice Reyes, ang ganda ng substantive law. But it doesn't show how many times a particular question was asked in the bar exam. It does not show also an example of a bar question. And it does not show how the suggested answer should be, how the answer should be given. Now, tingnan nyo sa book muna. Yung kanina diniscuss natin muna. Balikan natin. Article 3. Makalagay dito. How many times was it asked? 78, 18, 8, 96, 7, 8, 0, 1, 0, 0, 3, 4, 5, 6, 11, 13, 15. So, today is 2021. Baka itanong. No? Tingnan nyo dito siya. Sunod-sunod. Biglang tumalon. Nagkaroon ng gap dito ng ilang years. So, 5 years. Ito, 6 years. Most probably, this can be asked. Many times this was asked. Yung, nakita nyo naman. So, put a circuit. Put a star on this one. Now, since this is a favorite question, tingnan nyo how many times this was asked. No, tingnan nyo pala yung how a bar question was asked. So, walang problema naman. No? How are felonies committed? 2015. No problem. Codal provision. Memorize that. You have already points. No? There are also other questions na hindi ko na naipakita. Let's go to Article 4. How many times? Sunod-sunod yun. You can see that 99, blank, 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 9, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 18, hindi, walang 18 yan, this is 17, 19, 18, 21. Most probably, itatanong ito. Nalalagyan nyo ng star ito. No problem with you should know this already. Because aberratio ictus, error personae, preter intentionem, all come from Article 4, Paragraph A. Discuss natin yan. By committing a felony, what kind of a felony? We know that there is dolo and there's culpa. Which one? Both of them? To apply Paragraph 1 of Article 4? Although the wrongful act done be different from that which he intended. So, the intention. Ergo, this is applicable to only to dolo. Not culpa. No? So, applicable lang siya sa dolo. So, NA, not applicable to, number one, culpa. Not applicable to SPL. Not applicable to if a person is performing a lawful act. Paano yun? Halimbawa, A was after B. No, ano? Sabi ko, sa divisoria. Bigla na lang hinabol ni A ng palaksak si B. So, si B naman, he ran away. But later on, his back is against the wall. So, he has to face A. And there are so many bystanders. Alam mo naman yan, divisoria. So luckily for B, B fought, no? He got hold of the knife, so he threw the knife away. Unfortunately, there was a bystander by the name of X. Kinamaan yung ulo, patay. Tanong, is this applicable, no? Under the present circumstance that any person committing a felony should be liable although the wrongful act done be different from that which intended. So ang tanong, yung act ba ni B of throwing the knife, no, to stop the aggression, a crime? No, it's not a crime. He's perfectly what? Defending himself. So, if a person is exercising a lawful act, then he is not liable, even if X is died. Just an accident. Oh, assuming that there's culpa. Why? Because he knew that there are a lot of people and yet he threw this knife. Yet, this is still not applicable kasi applicable lang yan sa dolo, not culpa. Okay? So, careful with that. Now, out of this would come mistake in identity. Bar question, differentiate mistake in identity from mistake of fact. In mistake of identity, there is criminal liability. In mistake of fact, there is no criminal liability. Basis of mistake in identity is Article 4, Paragraph 1. Basis of mistake of fact is the case of people versus actual. Mistake in identity. Tatandaan nyo yan para hindi kayong malimutan. At malito with mistake in the blow. Mistake in identity, no, is error in personae. Mistake in the blow is aberratio. Now, remember that there are two persons only at the scene of the crime, si A saka si B. So, meron siyang grudge against B, so he waited for this person to walk in along this narrow street unlighted because he usually goes into that. He passes through this street every night after office. So A waited for B, and he waited to kill B. So somebody passed through this street, and A, believing it was B, stabbed this person. Unfortunately, it was not B, but another person, C. So there are two persons present, si A at si C. But A believed that C at the beginning that it was B. So there is mistake in identity and there is criminal liability. Sir, sabi niya, absent kasi siya sa lecture ko sabi niya, I have no intent to kill C because I was just intending to kill B. So if at all, negligent lang. Is his argument correct or not? No, because when he waited, he was planning to commit dolo. He was planning to kill, no, a person, but it turned out that it was not me, but another person. When you talk about mistake in the blow, there are three persons present at the scene of the crime: si A, si B, and si C. A intended to kill B, so he fired and shot at B. It hit B. The bullet passed through B, tumagos, and hit another person too by C. So how, what's the magic word in mistake in the blow? Ang magic word yan is lack of precision. Because of lack of precision, tumagus pa yung bala kasi o nag-ricochet. Sir, can it be a complex crime? Yes, it can ripen into a complex crime. If as a result, there are two or more grave or less grave felonies which was produced. Okay? Bawa, namatay si B, namatay si C. Grave felony yan. So, complex crime yan. Okay? Next. Traitor intentional is the last. Where they injury went beyond what was intended. A is sloppy. His intention is only to sloppy. Unfortunately, B fell down and died. Namatay si B. Tumama yung ulo niya sa pavement. So the injury went or beyond or injury is greater than that or beyond that which was intended. This will result into what? A mitigating circumstance. Mitigating circumstance under paragraph 3 of article 13, which is mitigating. Ano yun? Lack of intent to commit so grave a wrong. No intent to commit so grave a wrong. So that's a mitigating circumstance. When there is a notorious disparity between the act or means employed by the offender and the resulting felony. So disparity, which is notable disparity, the act of slapping and the resulting injury, which is the death of B. Okay, malinaw. And also, under paragraph 3, let me continue. I'm sorry, paragraph A of article 4. It speaks about proximate cause. Sabi natin, he who is the cause of the cause is the cause of the evil cause. No, a person who is performing a dolo or a intentional felony, a person who commits intentional felony is liable for what? Liable for DNL, direct, natural, and logical consequences of his unlawful act. Liable for the resulting injury. Any person who commits intentional felony is liable for the direct, natural, and logical consequences, be it a resulting injury. So, halimbawa, si A, si robbery 1, robbery 2, nag-declare ng hold up sa passenger jeep. Okay, natakot si X, tumalon, patay. Prosecuted for the death of X, R1 and R2 said that they're not liable because they did not kill X. They have no intention to kill X. Marangal ang kanilang hangarin, makakain lang. Diba? Makaraos lang at magkaroon ng konting pera pang kain. Although in the form of a holdup. Sabi niya, yun lang dapat ang liability natin. Namin. Question, is the argument tenable or not? It's not. Because of this. A person who is performing a dolo, intentional felony, holdup, diba, is liable for its direct, natural, logical consequences. So of that unlawful act. If there was no declaration of all that, no, X would not have been afraid and would not have jumped out of the passenger ship. But remember that tatandaan nyo, kung merong proximate, hindi lahat proximate cause. At meron ding intervening cause. Magkaiba ang kanyang consequence. This is under Article 4, Paragraph 1. Kahit Article 4, Paragraph nga, ang tanong, is a person liable for all the consequences of his unlawful act? Does a person who commit an intentional felony liable for all the consequences of his act? No. No. Why? He's only liable for DNL, which is the direct, natural, logical consequences of his unlawful act. If the resulting injury is not the direct, natural, logical consequences of his act, then there is no, this is not applicable. Now, if it is an intervening cause, no, liable only for the act or acts committed. That's it. Walang consequences of different from that which intended. Walang ganun. So dapat aalamin mo kung proximate or intervening cause. Kasi pag proximate cause, apply mo yung DNL. Dito walang DNL dyan. A slap B. A, inflicted physical injury on the person of B. And then only suffered slight physical injury sa kanyang hand. Hindi mortal wound. When he went home, he deliberately immersed his hand on a poisonous water. Contaminated water. Wala lang, trip niya lang. Knowing that his hand is wounded. And because of that, because of this act, he died. Rest in peace. Question, is A criminally liable for the death of B? No, it's not a proximate cause. There was an intervening cause. See, because B deliberately immersed his hand on a poisonous water, knowing that it's poisonous. Kung nagpakamatay man si B for any reason. So not liable because it's not a proximate cause. So does it follow that A is scot-free? No. Still liable. What will be the liability of A? Liability of A is for the act that he committed. And what is that? The act of slapping B. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. Okay. We will go to the last topic, which is impossible crime. But before that, tingnan nyo yung ano. That's why I want you to have a copy of my book. It's because of this. So, alam nyo yung favorite topic yan, and yet and then at least you would know how to be familiar when this was asked. Ang sabi ko sa inyo, you follow the form of RELAC. Reply. Apply, legal basis, application, conclusion. Okay? Again, reply, legal basis, application, and C stands for conclusion. Let's analyze, no? Ito nakalagay sa libro ko. Bar question 2004. On his way home from B, office, ZZ Road, Chipney, almost the same as that nung ano natin, illustration natin. Si ZZ boarded, ano, the Chipney. So, XX pulled grenade, announced a holdup. So, sabi niya kay Z, surrender mo yung wallet mo, cellphone, and your watch. So, fearful for his life, jump out of the vehicle, and he died. Is XX liable for Z's death? I will teach you on how to present your actions. Reply. No, you always have to know what is the last question para hanapin mo na kaagad. Is X criminally liable for Z's death? Okay. So you reply directly to that. Okay. Yes, XX is criminally liable for the death of ZZ. Okay, good. So meron na tayong R. Next. Legal basis. Article 44, paragraph 1 states that criminal law says so. Okay. Okay, meron tayong legal basis. Okay, check. Check ito. So, application. In the facts given, so application na tayo. Ito na yan. XX committed a felonious act when he pulled a grenade out and declared the holdup. It created an immediate sense of danger in the mind of C. That's the application. Lastly, conclusion. Consequently, the death of CC caused by fear from CC's act makes the latter criminally liable even if the result is different from that from his own intention. Tapos, we applied the real act. Kung if you are used to this, you will not even be thinking of what's next or next. It will be automatic. So you need to to practice. Now later on, kung kulang na yung oras, then yung conclusion nyo, pwede nyo nang tanggalin. O kaya yung reply and legal basis can be made as one. Lalo na kung 3 points lang ang binibigay. Like, is X criminally liable for CC's death? Yes, XX is criminally liable because Article 4.1 states that blah, blah, blah. So you can already put these two into one sentence. No? Legal basis, application, takto lang dapat yan. No? Conclusion is just a reiteration of your reply. Couch in different terms. Hindi naman copy-paste. So, XX, yes, XX is criminally liable for death of CC. Okay. Sabi niya dito, it makes the latter criminally liable even if the result is different from that which is own intention. It's the same. Palang ni-rephrase mo. No, ni-rephrase mo lang. Now, you could do away with conclusion if you want to. Basta meron kang legal basis and application. But if you have time naman, if you want to impress the examiner, no? Hindi ka kapo sa oras, then i-follow mo lahat yan. You will be given a full credit for this one. Okay, the last one. By any person performing an act which would be an offense, this is impossible crime. And which is also asked several times in the bar exams. What are the requisites of impossible crime? Nasa codal na yan, no? Performing an act which would be an offense against persons or property. Ergo, ang impossible crime, limited lang yan sa persons, a crime against persons or property. If it is not a crime against persons or property, do not apply paragraph 2. So si A kinidnap si isang tao, akala niya si B. From Manila to Pangasinan. It turned out that it was a person, not B, it was him. Ay mali. Meron bang impossible crime? Wala. Bakit? Kidnapping is what crime? Kidnapping is a crime against personal liberty. And it's not a crime against persons or property. So moral lesson, memorize nyo, what are the crimes classified or falling under crimes against persons? You also have to memorize crimes against property. Tingnan nyo, no? What else? Against persons or property, what other requisites? There is inherent impossibility of its accomplishment or an account of employment of inadequate or ineffectual means. Nakatatlo ko na dyan. When you talk about inherent impossibility, there are two kinds. Legal impossibility as well as physical impossibility. Legal impossibility. Can you steal a watch that belongs to you? No. Why? Because it's yours. Physical impossibility. Can you kill a person who's already dead? No. Why? Because he's already dead. So there is inherent impossibility. So A intended to kill B. No? Akala niya natutulog lang si B. Pinagsasaksak niya. It turned out that 1 hour before, B suffered a heart attack and already died. There is inherent impossibility. If A knew at the time that he stabbed and B, that B was already dead, then forget about the application of this one. It's not impossible crime. Employment of inadequate or ineffectual means. So ito yung, sorry. Try na lang natin. Si A gustong patayin si B. So naglagay siya ng substance ganito. Believing that volume is enough to kill B. Pero ang volume pala na kailangan, ito, this much. And that is unknown to A. There is, in this case, okay, employment of inadequate means. If A knew at that time that it is inadequate, then forget about the application of impossible crime. Employment of ineffectual means. Naglagay siya ng substance. Akala niya, he all the while thought that it was poison. And yung pala, it was only sugar. It was only sugar. So employment of ineffectual means. No, but A should know that it's a poison. If he knew it's only sugar, then impossible crime is not applicable. Of course, there's number 4, which is not included in the codal provision. So the act must not be punished or not constitute as a crime. It does not constitute as a crime under other provision of the RPC, or it's not punished under other provision of the RPC. If that act constitutes as a crime, then it's not impossible crime. Of course, there should be evil or criminal intent. A intended to kill B. Nipa-house lang si B, no? Sa bukid lang siya. So he hatched a plan to kill B. Pero B, unknown to A, B was already in Manila an hour ago. A week ago. Just to look for his mother. But all the while A thought that B was in his Nipa-hut. So after a few days, he planned on killing B. He burned his house of B. Di ba merong murder qualified by use of fire? So ganun. And he does not know that, he did not know at that time B was already in Manila. Is there impossible crime? Question, no. Why? Because that that act is already punished under other provision of the RPC. The crime that he committed is not impossible crime, but his act is already arson. So it's already arson. So you have to be very careful in that. So ang tanong is, sir, how do you differentiate, tinatanong sa barrio, impossible crime from frustrated or attempted felony? Ang attempted at frustrated, susceptible of being consummated. No? How do you say that? Because attempted, no, it can be consummated were it not for for reasons other than his own spontaneous desistance. For reasons other than his own spontaneous desistance. The other one is what? Ay, dapat nakikinig kayo, ha? Huwag kayong gagawa ng trabaho. Pag nakita ng Supreme Court yan, di pa pwede yan. You really have to set aside the time. You cannot drive, you cannot go into the office. And this is not for compliance purposes. I just like to remind everyone. Okay, number two, sana tayo. It can never be frustrated as well. Bakit? Hindi, it can never be frustrated. So frustrated is susceptible of being consummated. Were it not for acts independent of the will of the perpetrator. Pero ang impossible crime, it can never be consummated because of inherent impossibility or employment of inadequate or ineffectual means. So, ang tanong, pwede bang, ano, meron bang attempted or frustrated in impossible crimes? So, subjectively, there's a crime, he's a criminal, of objectively, there's no crime committed. Okay? What else? Let's look at the barrier questions. Oh. Tingnan nyo, ha? What is an impossible crime? Walang problema yan. Codal lang yan. So if you memorize the codal provision, very good. Can there be an impossible crime of adultery? No? Yun, masasagot niya. Tingnan nyo kagad, if the elements are within your fingertips, you can easily answer that. Of course, there is no impossible crime of adultery. Why? Ito yun. Because adultery is a crime against chastity. Impossible crime is only applicable to crimes against persons or property. Okay? Next. Puti detested Pula, his roommate, because Pula was courting Ganda, whom Puti fancied. 2014 bar. One day, Puti decided to teach Pula a lesson and went to a veterinarian to ask for a poison on the pretext that he was going to kill a sick pet. Well, actually, unknown to him, Puti was intending to poison Pula. The vet gave Puti a non-toxic solution. When mixed with Pula's food, did not kill Pula. But in effect, he believed that it was a poison. It was a non-toxic solution. What crime, if any, did Puti commit? So he committed impossible crime of murder. Okay? So yon, relax na naman, okay? So what crime? Puti committed the crime of impossible crime of murder. That's the reply. legal basis, Article 4, Paragraph 2, blah, blah, blah. And then it provides for the requisites. So we discussed this one-on-one. No? So the act should not be constituted as a violation of other provision of the RPC. Of course, there's inherent evil intent. And then you discuss all the elements are present in this case. Okay, why do you say that all the elements are present in this case? Number one, Putin's act of mixing a poison with Pula's food would have been murder, a crime against persons or property. Tama, diba? Tama naman. It is a crime against person or property. Person. Wawala yun. Annotate. Yun. Check. There was evil intent, di ba? There's a time, there's an intent to kill. Check. Inherently impossible. Yes, because it was done toxic solution. Next. It is not violate under other provision of the RPC. So, it will not fall any other violation of the RPC. And moreover, Puti believed that he was in possession of a poison. Or in fact, it is merely a non-toxic solution. Tapos. Would your answer be the same if as a result of the mixture, Pula got an upset stomach and had to be hospitalized for 10 days? What's your answer? This time, it's no longer be the same. It's different already. Why? Because he already committed the crime of less physical injuries. Less physical injuries if the victim got an upset stomach, and which necessitates for him to be confined at the hospital for 10 days. So, yun. In that case, it will constitute as a crime of less serious physical injuries. And the requirement is that it should not violate any provision of the RPC. So itong requirement which is not present in this case because na-hospitalize siya. Pag na-hospitalize siya, nagkaroon ng upset stomach, physical injuries na yun. Puti will not be liable for impossible crime, but they will be liable now for less serious physical injuries. Yun. Pagod na ako. Okay. So, I think that will be for today. You can already stop recording. Done.